And welcome back to some more White March Part 2. The Pillars of Eternity expansion. Cue the music. Now we have an entrance here. We have an entrance, I believe, there. As well as here, which is apparently more of a main entrance. I'm guessing these are two small buildings, so I'm gonna head over there first.
Sure.
And, how about a little faster while still sneaking? Be great. That's nothing. This goes up. Okay, it goes up here. So this might be two floors. They're gonna be rather small, though. Oh, that's all there is. Seriously? Okay. Never mind, we just got this main entrance to go down. Am I? Okay. And I thought I tried to sneak off. No, I guess not. Alright, the moment of truth, guys. Please, listen!
Enough! I've had my fill of... What's this?
Right, Adaryc.
Steady, men. Our guest has arrived.
The Iron Flail commander is a younger man, lean in build. His brown hair is unkempt, his eyes fevered. Oh, you look a sight, don't you? At his feet is a grate, set over what appears to be a pit. You hear a smattering of anxious cries rising from the cell as the commander steps forward. Who do you have down there?
All that chaos outside. For an instant, I believed you, woman.
His boot comes down hard on the grate. You believe me about what? I have yet to speak to you.
But she's only a common assassin.
He looks up at you. I'd prefer to settle this peacefully.
I'm sure you would, now that you're here.
Adaryc sneers.
You want to talk? Set down your...
Adaryc's words die in his throat, his expression frozen mid-snarl. It isn't clear what's happened. Not until you start to feel it, too. Unbidden, your senses drift, as if you had reached out toward a source of essence. You feel an ache in your chest, an almost painful sensation of being pulled forward. A sudden wave of memories floods your mind, clear as the day they formed. You see Odima's campsite, ravaged by the Biowic, the halls of Cadnua, the very beginning of the base game. In the caverns beneath the keep, the stone around you bellows warnings in a dead language. Deeper still, a fanged maw parts like a wound in the world. Wow, guys. Sorry, guys, I'm still, congested from a cold, so if I sound a little weird, that's why. The images wash over you, tracing lives and emotions from 100 different times and places. Not all are your own. Slowly, you become aware of the sensation of being watched. Ooh, who watches the watcher? Reach out. You direct your senses, tracing the invasion to its source. Adaryc. Conviction burns to him, bright as a brazier. For an instant, you share in his emotion, and a sourceless desperation rattles about your skull. Absent context, the fragments of memory you see are just images. A small house across a field of vibrant purple flowers, a sea of armored kith and flapping banners waiting on your command. There's an uncomfortable moment where you feel your twinned awareness turning in on itself, and then the connection is severed. Adaryc looks startled, his face ashen. That's never happened before. Kind of tempted to choose the cipher option, because it's a cipher option. You're a watcher?
You sure he's not just a weirdo with an empty stare? I get those confused a lot.
Adaryc.
That's not...
Adaryc glances around the room, his face coloring.
That's not known to many. Not past these walls. Why have you come? Why now?
You can see lost souls like I do?
Yes, I see them. Your butcher's work clings to you.
Adaryc's voice is flat, his posture tense. Huh. My butcher's work. What does he mean by my butcher's work? The fact that I've, you know, engaged in countless battles and killed people? And animals? Kith? You're ashamed. Why?
It's hardly something to be proud of. Look to your own sins, Watcher. I'll not share mine.
I don't want to goad him too much. I was afraid of both of these. Or kind of like goading. Are you as tired of listening to dead people as I am? Something in common, right? Common bond?
You add to their number by the day. Does it not strike you as a fitting punishment?
I thought all the other Watchers were mad.
That wouldn't bode well for you, would it?
Adaryc's tone is irritable, but he watches you with wary interest.
I've a firm grip on my senses, whatever you believe. The Watcher's curse is many things, but if it promised madness, I would not have taken command of the Iron Flail. The memories I saw, some of them couldn't have belonged to you. You're awakened, aren't you?
Are you also awakened?
No, of course not.
He studies you with a grim fascination. Do you know of a cure? Adaryc stares at you. Eventually, he gives a slight shake of the head.
It seems a terrible thing to be awakened and a watcher both. I'm sorry.
Enough about that. I don't want to attack him. If I don't... At least not if I don't have to.
Yes, we were in the middle of something, I believe.
About our mutual condition.
You've come all this way to indulge your curiosity?
He seems a little relieved at your discretion. Yeah, we'll ask him. I take it Watchers don't enjoy the best reputation in Red Saras.
Does everyone in the Deerwood boast of their afflictions?
In the brief quiet that follows, Adaryc looks very tired, but he does not lower his sword.
Yes, we were in the middle of something, I believe.
What did these people do to make you throw them in a pit?
Stalwart sent delegates to discuss terms of peace. I offered them the opportunity. I was generous.
Adaryc paces a few steps before he gets hold of himself. Okay, so the question about the delegates and the one I chose basically lead to the same thing. The delegates are down there. He was generous.
But Stalwart sent soothsayers, not diplomats. To frighten us with stories of the moon going dark, the earth shaking.
Raving delegate yells, "It's true! It's all true! The waves will swallow us all!" A shrill voice suddenly rises up from the pit. Adaryc stomps down angrily on the bars, drowning her out. Well, I did hear the voice, I just didn't hear stomping. What do you want with Stalwart, anyway?
With a village of fishermen, nothing. But they cling fiercely to the forge you gave them. Some of the men are here for gold and good steel, and I promised them their share. But I came for cannons. With the battery's cannons, we can hold the pass. Raid Saris has suffered enough. Its sons and daughters have nothing. We...
He looks at Adair, jaw working.
We won't survive an attack from the Deerwood when it comes. Not unless we act. There is an army coming. I've seen it. Pouring down from the mountain. It will crush Stalwart and come for Raid Saris.
Adaryc's gaze is distant.
The Iron Flail will be the wall that safeguards my homeland from the worst these fire worshippers can bring to bear.
You had a vision of an army. Darian mentioned you had a vision. Intellect option between a duke's assassination and the Hollowborn crisis. Deerwood's a little preoccupied. What makes you think the Deerwood's going to attack? That's why you're here. If the Deerwood does attack, you brought it on yourselves. The Deerwood's my home now, and I'll defend it with my life, or just attack. I'll choose the intellect option. Between the Duke's assassination and the Hollowborn crisis, Deerwood's a little preoccupied.
So I believed. Hoped, maybe. But that only means they're angry. They'll look for someone to blame, an enemy to fight.
What makes you think the Deerwood is going to attack?
I've seen it. Like a memory plucked from the dead. But this was a warning from the gods. I can't sit back and do nothing.
So wait, you had a vision of an army?
I warn you, if you think to taunt me, Watcher.
Right, I can tell about my vision. The dream that I had, right before I came back here. At the keep. Darian mentioned you had a vision, that's why you're here. Yeah, I'll tell him. I had a vision too. In mine, I saw Defiance Bay and Cadnua reduced to rubble by an army that shook the earth. Doubt creases Adaryc's brow. His men exchange looks, waiting tensely for orders.
Why would they turn on their own? No. You're trying to trick me. This is all another distraction.
It would be cool if we can get these guys on our side. I'm not completely sure if that's possible. I'm going to choose option 2, actually, even though I'm tempted to go for the intellect option. I remember thunder and 100 eyes gazing back at me. Any of that sound familiar?
The thunder followed me to the temple at Dawn's Reach, and the earth split beneath our feet.
Adaryc swallows and looks unsure. I thought the Iron Flail might be the army in my own vision. Perhaps we both made a mistake.
Why should I believe any of this? You would say anything at all to protect Stalwart.
Excuse me. Getting weird throat noises. You read my soul. What did that tell you?
That you're soft-hearted. But it hasn't seemed to stop you.
Adaryc's voice is brittle.
And that you have seen and done a great many things. Things I would not have otherwise believed.
I like this. Hope it works out. If not, I'll be disappointed. We both know something's coming. Maybe two watchers can figure out how to stop it. For several moments, there is nothing but silence in the cabin. Then you hear the scrape of metal as Adaryc takes up his sword, only to lay it flat across his palms. What does that mean?
I led my people here because I believed we were on the right path. I bound my soul to this blade as proof of my surety.
There's a ripple of soul energy in the air, there and gone. Adaryc looks pained.
The sword's no good to me now. It's yours. For as long as you can wield it.
So we've gained the sword called Steadfast.
I'll call in our forces from the mountains. Please, give me time to explain. You should speak with Stalwart's messengers. Perhaps you'll get some answers out of them.
Thetis was granted Sever the Soul. Don't I already have that? Adaryc, imprisoned the Stalwart delegation in a cell built into the earth floor of his cabin. With the commander of the way, they can be released. Well, that's excellent. Before I let them go, though, let's look around here. Let's sneak in case there's any secrets. Like that? That's a book, though.
Time to see and not be seen.
Alright. Potion of Fleet Feet. 166 copper. Potion of Langrath, Displaced Image. Some more of that dirt jerky. Another Langrath's. 20 gold. I'll save that for last, I don't know. Just a regular dagger. I believe I have that. Let's give it to the barbarian. We got a lot of this Langrath's Displaced Image potions. Already full of that. Camping supplies. Wait, I'm pressing the wrong thing. Alright, let's check out this book. Boots of Speed. Plus 3 move speed. And a diamond. Let's see. What kind of boots are we wearing here? Boots of Evasion. Plus 2 reflex. Zealous Command. Stealth. Yeah, he needs that. Echoing Misery. That's handy. Keep that. Yeah, I like that. Okay, we're gonna put this into stash then. And speaking of stash, I want to see if we have the Light of Dawn. I'm pretty sure we do. If not, it looks like that. Yep, part 2. Oh, we got part 1. Is there another part? Avian Burnett. Missives of the Hand Occult. I believe it's a new book. I might just read it now then, yeah. Characters, in order of appearance. So this is The Light of Dawn, a Readceran Morality Play Part 1. We've only ever had part 2. which I've read before. So the characters are man, male, a ghostly being, female, ghostly being, beggar, starving man, and injured man. Setting, empty field, no trees or buildings in sight. A man lies on the ground, center stage. He wakes slowly and looks around. Two ghostly beings approach him, a male from the stage left, a female from stage right. The man says, "Where am I? What has happened?" The male says, "Nothing has happened." "How did I get here?" The female says, "You did not arrive. You were just here." "What is going on?" And they both say, "You are traveling. We will travel with you." They both reach out a hand to him insistently. He looks at them, not sure what to do. After a few moments of deliberation, he takes the male's hand and allows him to help. Male, to the female, says, "His soul is strong. This decision will be easy." Female says, "Such arrogance surely will be your undoing." They walk to the end of the stage and encounter a beggar, holding out a bowl. "Will you help the needy? Will you hear the call of charity? What will you do for those less fortunate?" The male says, "Here is a beggar. What will you do? He has no food, no clothes. He is destitute and will surely die if no mercy is shown him." Female says, "Surely he deserves no mercy. Look to his legs. Do they not move? Look to his arms. Can he not work? Look to his eyes. Can I not see? Surely he can provide for himself." They both say together, "What will you do?" The man beggars. The man ponders for a moment, then reaches into his pocket and drops a coin in the beggar's bowl. "Thank you, kind sir. May your charity come back to you in turn." They both say, "Why did you give alms to the beggar?" "I saw a man in need. It is not for me to say if he deserves mercy, only that I need provide mercy if I am able. I have the means to help, so I help. If he has the ability to provide for himself and does not, that is on his head, not mine. If I can provide the light of dawn to a man in need, it is my duty to do so." The male says to the female, "He knows charity, even disguised as a beggar. His mind is open." The female says, "Even those with an open mind can be closed down." The male and female say together, "Let us continue our journey." They walk to the other edge of the stage, leaving the beggar behind. They approach the starving man, who puts out his hands in supplication. "A crust? A morsel? Please, surely generosity will not allow you to stand by and let someone starve." The male says, "This man is starving. What will you do?" "He is on the brink of death. Only an act of generosity will save him." The female says, "What need has this man that he cannot provide for himself? Why should you turn over that which you earned to one who has done no such act and who deserves nothing from you?" They both say together, "What will you do?" Again, the man considers what he will do. He reaches into his pocket and retrieves a piece of bread and gives it to the starving man. "Thank you. Thank you, good sir. May your generosity be returned unto you tenfold." They both say, "Why did you give food to the hungry?" "I saw a man who hungered. It is not for me to say if he deserves a morsel, only that I need provide a morsel if I am able. I have the food to spare, so I give. If I can open a man's eyes to the light, it is my duty to do so." The male says to the female, "He knows generosity, even disguised as a starving man. His heart is giving." The female says, "Even those with a giving heart can be greedy." The male and female say together, "We will continue our journey." Now, you know what? I don't really remember the events of part two, so I'm going to read that now. Hope you guys don't mind. My voice is getting scratchy. Let me take a drink here. Hold on a sec. Right, so this probably didn't make a lot of sense when I first read this. They walk back to the first location, leaving the starving man behind. They approach the injured man, who lifts his head and winces. "A balm? A salve? Surely you know compassion. Surely you can spare anything, even your time, to help me?" The male says, "This man is injured and cannot help himself. He is certain to die if someone does not apply ointment and bandages to his wounds. Such compassion could mean his life." The female says, "You owe nothing to this man. Surely his injuries are the judgment of his God. He has been tried and found wanting. His punishment is none of your concern." They both say, "What will you do?" The man weighs his options and kneels down beside the injured man. He administers ointment on the man's stomach and wraps a bandage around them. Bless you. May the compassion you show to those less fortunate be shown to you all your days. They both say, why did you dress the wounds of the injured? I saw a man who was bent and broken. It is not for me to say he has no right to his health. I'll either help heal if I am able. I have the time to give, so I give. If I can help in a man's rebirth, it is my duty to do so. The male says to the female, he knows compassion, even disguised as an injured man. His spirit is willing. The female answers, even those with a willing spirit can refuse those in need. They both say, we will continue our journey. They walk to the center of the stage where the beggar, starving man, and injured man now stand. The male says, what say you three? What is the nature of this man's soul? The beggar says, I am charity. I know the mind of one who gives freely. This man was willing to give me his last coin. His mind is righteous. His soul is pure. The starving man says, I am generosity. I know the heart of one who withholds nothing from those in need. This man was willing to give me his last scrap of bread. His heart is giving. His soul is pure. The injured man says, I am compassion. I know the spirit of one who will sacrifice for the greater good. This man was willing to stay with a stranger and care for him in his time of need. His spirit is merciful. His soul is pure. The male says, what say you, Magrin? The female says, the trial is complete. The judgment has been made. The decision is final. This man has shown charity, generosity, and compassion to those in need. His soul will be reborn. What say you, Aethys? The male says, the judgment is final. The decision has been made. He turns to the man. Be on your way. Your soul's transformation has begun. Welcome the light of the new dawn. So is this some depiction of how souls become reborn? Interesting. All right. Let's let these poor souls out. And let's show compassion. I don't even know when we got that key. The dwarven delegate says, oh, thank you. I thought we'd never get out of there. Are you hurt? No. A little bruised, perhaps. The cold was the worst part. The frightened delegate says, I don't know how you managed to talk that man down. He was practically foaming at the mouth. Dwarven delegate says, and now he and his men are still skulking around the mountains. I'm not sure letting him live was the best idea. Well, there's also a gruff delegate who says the commander wasn't the problem. One of the delegates points an accusing finger at another, a woman standing apart from the rest. Is that the woman? We might have come to terms if she hadn't goaded him, shouting at him about omens and curses, demanding he leave the march. You know how superstitious the Readcerans are. The commander went white as a sheet. She sabotaged the meeting. That's the woman. The raving delegate. The woman in question is dressed in unassuming robes. She bears the accusation silently, her eyes closed as if in prayer. Good work. Who are you? With desperate speed, the woman suddenly lunges sidelong toward a nearby rack and seizes a dagger lying there. She sets the blade to her own throat. That dagger, I could have taken it. No! What? I wonder if that still would have happened if we had taken the dagger. Unseen to all but yourself, the dying woman's soul essence coils in thin wisps about her body. It only grows brighter as her corpse stills. The remaining delegates stare in horror at her pooling blood. Maneha kneels by the dying woman and inspects her robes. She examines a crescent medallion hanging around the woman's neck. The frightened delegate says, what just happened? The gruff delegate says, damn it! Now we'll never get an answer out of her. Not unless I read her soul. They pull your names out. I like that. Let's just read her soul. I'm afraid if I don't do it now, I might not get a chance later in dialogue. You reach out, embrace against a sudden flare of pain and fear, digging after less recent events. There's a copper taste in your mouth, and pain like fire in your throat. Under the brute terror of death, you find a comforting thread of resolve, of satisfaction in duty fulfilled. You follow it.